Christ alone, our chief cornerstone. No other foundation can we build upon. Not philosophy, nor the wisdom of man. All other ground is sinking sand. Upon this rock, you build. And the gates of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth. And in Jesus' name, we will not fail. Never.
Crucified, raised up from the dead, let captivity captive, it is finished. Oh, he gave us the keys, his authority, now we are joined.
Build your church. 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 Build your Well, hello and welcome to this unexpected online gathering of Grace Church. It is so very good to have you here this Sunday morning. Now, I'll talk a little bit more during my message today with regards to what has happened during the week that means we're gathering online rather than in person. But good news is, as long as nothing too much changes between now and next Sunday, we will resume in-person gatherings from Sunday the 14th of November. All the details the same as they were supposed to be today, but it's all going to be happening next Sunday. Once again, we'll send out some confirmation text during the week to let you know that that is all happening. Now, I wanted to fill you in as well, some things happening in my life after almost a decade in my other job at Rhema 99.7, the radio station. This week was my last week. I've been feeling for pretty much all of this year, actually, that my time was coming to an end, and really just wasn't too sure on God's timing in that, but became clear probably over the last couple of months that the time was finishing. So I wrapped things up this past week. It was a fun journey. I really enjoyed it, and I want to thank you for your encouragement and your support, and also for your grace for allowing me to be pastoring Grace Church, but also doing something else that I love. Now, what it actually means is that officially now I am a full-time pastor. So you'll probably be hearing more from me during the week. And I'm excited about it because we've been feeling for a while that in 2022, God's going to be doing some mighty things through Grace Church. And I don't want to speak for him because obviously his plans are perfect, mine are not, his timing perfect, mine not, etc., etc. But I do get a sense in my spirit that I've got a couple of months just to kind of rest and get ready for what he wants to bring through Grace Church in 2022. So I'm very much looking forward to that, very excited about that. And I hope that you can be praying for Jackie and myself as we prepare not only to regather, but also to head into 2022. We're very excited about our vision for next year. And as I said, you know what we believe God's going to do in and through Grace Church. Also excited to be bringing you a message today that is coming up for you. But for now, let's get back into worship, some extended worship, as we push into the presence of God. My hope and my prayer is that he would really minister to you through this time of worship.
When I'm at my end, you just getting started. When I hit a wall, you just walk through. When I face a mountain, you are the maker, so it's gotta move. When I'm out of faith, and you are still faithful. When I'm at my worst, and you are still good. In all of my questions, you are the answer. It all points to you. 'Cause you're the God of the breakthrough. When I'm breaking down, you'll be working a way through. When there's no way out, this one thing I know, that you're still on your throne. So whatever I'm feeling, When I'm breaking down, you'll be working a way through. When there's no way out, there's one thing I know. You're still on your throne. So whatever I'm feeling, I still got a reason to praise, praise, praise. I still got a reason to praise, praise, praise. I still when I'm breaking, you'll be working. Ooh. When there's no way out, this one thing I know, that you're still on your throne. So whatever I'm feeling, I still got a reason. this moment, in every season, this is your promise. Jesus, you reign. Jesus, you reign. Over the city, over our families, under your covering, Jesus, you reign. Jesus, you reign. And our God
I do love that song, and I love that extended time of worship this morning. I really hope that you felt the presence of God. Sometimes I just get these tingles, like all over my body. I just physically feel His presence, and I just kind of relax into that, and I just so enjoy those moments, and that was definitely something that I experienced this morning. So today, what I actually want to do is I want to camp in the book of James. So if you've got your Bibles, then please turn there. Chapter 1 is where we're actually going to spend some time, because what I actually want to do is I want to bounce a little bit off what Jackie shared last week. Now, Obviously, things haven't quite gone according to plan for Grace Church this week. Now, of course, we were supposed to be gathering together again in person for the first time in a number of months, I think from August 6th. So that would make it about 3 months. And I was so excited about it. I know that you have been so very excited about it. All the plans were in place. I'd spent a significant amount of time writing up a new COVID safe plan. That's always a fun way to spend your time. But Tuesday morning, something happened in the Heinsohn household that threw all of that just out the window, because at about 7:20 in the morning, as we were getting the kids ready to head off to school, we received a text message from the school. Here's what it said, and it's on the screen there for you. Dear 3C, COVID positive student on site in 3W Monday morning, please keep 3C child at home and have COVID test. Now for us, 3C is actually the class that Tobias is in. So he stayed home as directed on that morning. About 3 hours later, we got some messages and emails from the school advising that now the whole junior school had now been closed and we had to go and collect our other children who were in junior school. So we had to get there as soon as possible. Literally, it was kind of like we got the email and they wanted us there half an hour later, if that was at all possible. So Jackie went and picked up Ariella. Oh no, Ariella stayed there, but she picked up Adeline and she picked up Leilani and brought them home. Ariella stayed for the rest of the day and then came home on the school bus as normal. Now, by the end of the week, most of the kids were actually back at school again, except for Tobias. Now, Tobias was considered, because he was in that year at level at school, he's considered a close contact and so actually needs to isolate at home for 2 weeks. Can I tell you, it is quite a challenge to isolate one child when you have a total of six and two adults in the mix as well. But after we kind of as a family adjusted to that, my thoughts went to, what impact is this going to have on our in-person church gathering? And I talked to some elders, I got some wisdom from them, and we all decided that the best approach for us in terms of keeping you safe, keeping our community safe, was actually to postpone our return of in-person gatherings. Now, of course, none of this was actually expected. We didn't expect to have to keep Tobias home for 2 weeks. We didn't expect to get a notice from the school advising there was a positive COVID case. And it was unexpected for us, particularly as a family, because the kids pretty much had just returned to school. They'd only been back, I think, maybe a week or two, and then we're having to keep them home again, at least one of them. So it wasn't really, for us, it's not really a major thing. It's more of a disruption than anything. It disrupted the plans that we had actually put in place. But it got me thinking and led me to today's message, because I think life is pretty much like that. We make all these plans and then something unexpected happens and it gets in the way of the plans that we've made, and those plans have to change. Now, for you, it might not be about, you know, kids leaving school or remote learning or anything like that, but it could be having to change travel plans at the last minute. It could be that your hairdresser calls you and lets you know that that long-awaited appointment has been cancelled because they just can't fit you in. Maybe it's having to wait for hours and hours at a doctor's surgery when you thought you'd just duck in, see the doctor, and pop out. Now, events like this in life, they can be frustrating, they can be annoying, but there's actually other things that happen to us along the life journey that are actually much more, or they affect us much more deeply. And it could be something like an unexpected medical diagnosis. It might be, you know, the breakdown of a relationship. It could be a major change in financial circumstances. It could be the loss of a loved one. And those are the kind of things that I really want to talk about today as we look here at the book of James. Because these kind of things, they can knock us to the ground. They can lead us to depression or mental health challenges. And sadly, sometimes what they actually do is they lead people to take their own lives. It's such a sad, sad thing. And as followers of Jesus, sometimes we can think we're immune from all of that because we're following Jesus. But the truth is, these sort of things do come our way. And for us, it might not be taking our own life, but it might actually, in a spiritual sense, be taking our own life, our spiritual life. Because what we do is we actually ask questions about the goodness of God. We wonder, does God actually love me if he's allowing me to go through things like this? And sometimes people actually think, oh, this is happening to me because of my sins. It's a punishment for that. So what I actually want to do today is I want to take a look at the book of James and see what it has to say about this particular topic. Now, Jackie mentioned last week that it sort of feels like we're in the last days, that Jesus is about to return, that much tribulation is ahead. And so I want to sort of speak into that and hopefully equip you when it comes to what I believe is to come. Now, of course, we don't know the day, we don't know the hour when Jesus will return. Only God is aware of that. But I do believe, and I'm not sure, some people I've spoken to, they're in agreement with me on this, but I do believe that we can say with a fair degree of certainty that current world events point to the fact that we are closer to the return of Jesus than we have ever been. So my message today is called Remain Steadfast, and I really hope that it encourages you for the days and the months that are ahead. So I want to pray before we get into the meat of our message today. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you are always in control, and I thank you, Lord God, that your timing is perfect. I thank you too, Lord God, that you promise to never leave us, to never abandon us, to never forsake us, that no matter what we go through, that you are there by our side. So I pray this morning, Lord God, for hearts that are surrendered. I pray for spirits that are hungry. And I pray, Lord God, for minds that are switched off. And I mean that so that we don't allow our thoughts to cloud your truth that we will unpack today. So bless us, I pray, in Jesus' mighty and precious name. Amen. So, as I said, today's message is called Remain Steadfast, and we're looking at the book of James. But what I actually want to do is, before we dig into these passages, I want to give you some context, because there's several men in the Bible named James. We need to make sure that we're actually talking about the correct James. I don't want you to get confused, okay, because there's James, the brother of John and the son of Zebedee. We also have James, the son of Alphaeus, who is another of the disciples. I was reading this preparing today and I'm thinking, why are there two disciples named James? That's just confusing for you and me 2,000 years later. I mean, Simon got a new name. Couldn't Jesus have renamed James as well so that it was much easier a couple of thousand years later? I know. You ponder that if you will. I digress. I'm sorry. And also, if you think about in Acts 1, I think it is, we read about James, the father of Judas. Now, this book, this James who has written this book that bears his name, is none of those James. All right? I don't want you to get confused. They are other men whose name is James. The James that we talk about here is the brother of Jude. And if you know, in Acts 15, Jude is actually, he's the one that leads the church in Jerusalem. But the important thing that we need to get in context, because it really sets up for us what we're going to read today, is that the James that we talk about here is actually the half-brother of Jesus. And we read about this in Matthew 13, verse 55. In the New Living Translation, it says, "Then they scoffed. He's just the carpenter's son," obviously talking about Jesus, "he's just the carpenter's son, and we know Mary, his mother, and his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas." And I was thinking about this, and I thought, it makes perfect sense, doesn't it? If you were the brother of the Messiah, surely you would just have a quiet conversation with him and say, "Hey, Jesus, look, I've written some stuff. I think it's pretty good. What do you reckon if we can get it in the collection of books and other writings from people? Do you reckon we could just kind of just slip it in there towards the end of what will become the New Testament? You know, let's just put that in there." Now, of course, that didn't happen. We know that the Word of God is God-breathed and it's God-inspired. But it did get me thinking about the fact that James and Jesus are related. Now, the other important thing that we need to know in terms of this relationship, or why it's so important, is because it establishes that relationship between Jesus and James. And we actually start to see this right at the outset in chapter 1, verse 1. Here's what we read. James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greeting. Count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet various trials, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And then if we skip down to verse 12, we read this. Blessed is the man who endures trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. And I love this part of James. There's obviously verses in between. I encourage you to read them, but for the sake of time, we're not going to dig into all of that. But, you know, there is obviously a section that we have skipped over. But the thing that I find interesting is that James doesn't actually boast about his relationship with Jesus. He's not, you know, writing in capital letters in bold and underlining it. I'm James. I'm the brother of Jesus, or anything like that. He's just not doing that. And I think there's many people in the world, and I had to kind of like check my own spirit during the week, but I think there's many people in the world, if they had the chance, that's exactly what they would do. You know, they just do a little bit of name dropping. Oh yeah, Jesus, the Messiah. Yeah, the King of Kings. Yeah, mate, he's my brother. That's my bro. Do you know what I mean? And then my thinking got towards this age that we live in, this social media age where there is a lot of self-promotion. I wonder, in the modern context, if someone was the brother of Jesus, would they have posted a lengthy post and lots of photos on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram declaring that relationship? I don't know. It's mere speculation, of course, because James doesn't do any of that. Jesus, from James's point of view, Jesus is just his brother. And that was the nature of their relationship. And I've got two brothers myself. I've got obviously three boys, so they're brothers. And brothers don't tend to think that they're special. They're like, that's my brother. Yeah, I love him. He's great. But we don't tend to, you know, kind of elevate them or anything along those lines. And we actually see, when it comes to James, in John chapter 7, verse 5, we read that James was actually unreceptive to the message that Jesus was bringing. And it wasn't actually until he had this post-resurrection encounter with Jesus that James actually began to believe what it was that Jesus was saying. I'm sure if you saw your brother die and then you saw him resurrected to life, it would at minimum get you thinking about the words that he has been saying. But for James, following this encounter, he became one of the most dedicated followers of Jesus. There's an early history of the church. Some study there said that James was such a man of prayer that his knees had these large and thick calluses, and they kind of resembled the knees of a camel. If you've ever seen a camel, you know what they would look like. But that is the man of God that James became. He spent so much time that is how his knees actually looked. Now, knowing that James was the half-brother of Jesus makes this self-introduction all that more significant. Remember, he says, I am James. But as James begins to write, we can see humility that is just flowing through him. It's shining through him. Because he describes himself as a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there's no pretension. There's no proclaiming himself the brother of Jesus. There's none of this, don't you know who I am? Don't you know who my brother is? There's nothing like that at all. There's just a servant's heart and a declaration that Jesus, his brother, mind you, but Jesus was now his Lord, as well as his brother. That's a pretty strange place, and I think a pretty strong place for someone to be, when you can see your brother beyond who he is and who God has created him to be. Of course, here Jesus is God, but I think for siblings, in terms of the natural world that we live in, it's great if we can see them as God sees them. Now, most of that, I've got to tell you, has nothing too much to do with our message today. I just found that relationship between James and Jesus to be fascinating. And I came, you know, upon some of that as I was researching this week and just thought that I would share it with you. So I want to go to verse 2 and 3 now, because this is what we read. Count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet various trials, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Now, I don't know about you, but I sometimes get to passages like this in my Bible, and I don't know, it gets like a little bit icky, because I know, like I do, I know that we should be joyful when trials come our way. I've read this verse many times, as I'm sure you have. We should be joyful knowing that all the bad stuff that is going on in our world is part of what needs to happen before Jesus returns. But gee, it's hard sometimes, isn't it? Don't you think? Don't you think going through trials and stuff is difficult? It's challenging. It wears you down. It's hard when you're in constant pain to actually be counting that joy. It's hard to, I guess, count your blessings when there's no food in the fridge or the cupboards and the bank accounts are empty. It's hard to celebrate the joys of marriage when all that you are doing is constantly fighting with your spouse each and every day. Now, can I just assure you, the Heinzen marriage is going very, very well at the moment. We've had a couple of rocky roads, but right now things are going very well. And I say thank you, Jesus, for that continuing. But these trials are difficult. And I know for me personally, I'm not sure for you, but I know for me, my first reaction isn't to count them as joy. It most certainly isn't. You know, when we found out that Tobias had to stay at home for 2 weeks and be isolated, I didn't jump up and down with joy and say, thank you, Jesus, that my son has to be excluded. You know, when you've got to take your 9-year-old for a COVID test, there's no joy in that experience. But James makes it very clear that trials will come our way. He uses that word there on the screen in yellow. You'll see it. He uses when rather than if. When rather than if there in verse 2. And that speaks to a certainty. It speaks to something that is definitely going to happen. There's no doubt about it. It's not this possibly could happen at some point of time or if this happens. It is a when. There's 100% certainty that these things are going to happen. But it also made clear that we have a choice in that verse. We have a choice when it comes to how we handle trials. We can't stop them because they are going to come, but we actually have a choice in terms of how we deal with them and how we do the journey through those trials. Now, we can allow them to bring about discouragement or sadness or any other type of negative emotion. And I'm sure that we've all been there, even momentarily. You know, you get some bad news or something happens and, you know, the first thing is you go to that negative place, those negative thoughts, those negative emotions. But we can also choose to be joyful through those difficult seasons. And here's why we can do that. Because hopefully you know, and I know, that God is doing something in and around us as we journey through trials. I know I've said this before, and if you've heard it before, I hope that it really has stuck with you, because I think it's worth repeating again. There's no waste in the kingdom of God. There's no waste in God's kingdom. Everything happens for a reason, and God uses everything for a purpose. And if you're going through some tough stuff right now, I know you might just, you know, kind of dismiss that and go, oh yeah, that sounds nice, but that's not my reality. I understand when you're in the tough season, it can be hard to see that. But I do want you to grab hold of that as a truth. Because I think deep down, even if we're walking through the darkest valley that we've ever been, I think deep down, we all know that if we've been following Jesus for any length of time. And then we can see how that is actually detailed for us in verse 3. It says, "For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness." For you know. James is reminding us that deep down, we really do know that there is a reason for everything. Even though at a particular moment, temporarily, we might forget that. I think James is kind of just, you know, giving us just a gentle tap on the shoulder and reminding us the truth is otherwise. So I want you to make note of a very important truth. If you're only going to take one thing away from today's message, it's this. Faith is tested through trials, not produced by trials. Faith is tested through trials. It's not the result of actually going through the trials. And that's because our faith is built upon the Word of God. And we read that very clearly, say in a verse like Romans 10, 17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Supernaturally, faith is built in us when we hear, when we understand, when we meditate upon, when we trust in God's Word. So you might be wondering then, well, what's the purpose of these trials? Why do we have to go through them? Well, what trials actually do is they reveal the level of faith that we have. And that's not because, you know, God doesn't know where we're at with our faith journey. Of course he does. But they actually allow us to see the level of faith that we have. But also, it allows other people to see the level of faith that we have. And when we do the tough journeys well, our unsaved or pre-saved family and friends or work colleagues, when they see us doing that, it's such a powerful testimony. It's a witness. And I know that I've had conversations with people, you know, where they've said, look, I had the opportunity to actually talk about my faith because somebody saw how I was going through this challenge so well. And that's what these trials do. They help us to see our levels of faith, be that a little or be that a lot. And they also bring about something which is very, very important for us when it comes to our Christian life. And that is this word steadfastness. Steadfastness. Now, it actually means to be firmly fixed in place, not subject to change, to be firm in belief. An example, a practical example for you might be, you know, you're talking to someone about how much you love Jesus and you know, all of those kind of things. But then they give you a question along the lines of, well, was Jesus really the Son of God? You know, they start to sort of question what you believe. But when your reply is, yes, of course he was, what you've done is you remain steadfast. You haven't moved in your belief, but rather you've stood there on what you know to be true and remained steadfast. It's such an important thing. But sadly, it appears to me as I observe the church, the global church, capital C, that many have actually lost their ability to remain steadfast. When the winds of cultural change sweep through, some people get lost in joining the crowd and they drift away from the truth of God's word. I mean, the devil's got to be laughing at the deception that people are embracing. It's just, it's head scratching for me. I just don't understand it. Now, for others, when difficult trials come, they uproot themselves and they disconnect from God. They run away from him. They hide. They do a whole bunch of things. And really, it pains me when followers of Jesus do this kind of stuff. Rather than choosing to remain steadfast, choosing to hold on to and never let go of their beliefs and believe that God is using that moment of time, that season, for something that will work out for his good and for our good. so important for us to remain steadfast. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58 tells us this: "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Now, that's going to be a verse like that. That's going to be so much important in the days and the time to come. As the world continues to move away from Jesus, as the world becomes more secular, as kids continue, more and more kids grow up without that foundation of Christianity, as the media continues to push an anti-Jesus agenda and an anti-church narrative, it's more important than ever that we as the church stay standing and remain steadfast. Now, let's not kid ourselves that that's an easy thing to do. It's not. And I'll be honest with you. The easy thing to do is to lie down or to walk away. And there's many times where I've wanted to do that. But in those times, I've had to tell myself again and again, and this is a phrase that I've been repeating for a lot of this year, actually: remain steadfast, remain steadfast, remain steadfast. Don't allow what you're feeling to stop you from standing on the truth of who God is and His Word. And James knew that it was difficult, but it didn't stop him. In fact, eventually, I don't know if I should share this with you, because it's not encouraging, I don't think, eventually it led to his death. James was martyred in Jerusalem. He was pushed off a high point of a temple. He fell to the ground. God protected him. The fall didn't kill him. But what actually happened when he was on the ground is that he was beaten to death. But do you know what James did as he was being beaten to death? He prayed for his accusers. I don't know if I'm doing that. I'm not sure about you, but I think for me, I'm highly likely not doing that. Yet for James, and hopefully for you and for me, he knew that there was something much more than just his time here on earth, this time that you and I have been blessed to walk this planet that we are on. He knew that this time, this life that we have, this physical body that we have, is but just a little blip in all of eternity. And so when we head to verse 12, he actually encourages us to maintain that same kingdom eternal perspective. Here's what he said: "Blessed is the man who endures trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him." Now, I know we read that verse and we think, hold on, you sure that's not out of Matthew chapter 5, Wayne? You sure not? That's not part of the Beatitudes that Jesus shared on the Sermon on the Mount? I promise you it's not. But what it is, it's a declaration or a promise that there is indeed blessing through trials and tribulations. There's a promise of blessedness given to those who endure through all of those tough things that come in our life. And I know that we all want to be blessed, but sometimes we don't, I guess, align blessedness with trials. But that's exactly what James tells us here in verse 12. There appears to be a special gift of blessedness from God to the one who can say no to giving up and walking away, but who also says yes, or instead says yes, to remaining steadfast in God. Can you see that there, church? Can you see in that particular verse? James reminds us that it really is worth our while to endure the trials that we face. Our steadfastness will be rewarded as we demonstrate our love for Jesus. And what's that reward? Well, it's the victor's crown. It's the crown of life. It's a symbol of ruling and of reigning in a power and authority that has been given to us. So what we can metaphorically do when a trial is coming or we're in the middle of it is we can take our crown and we can put it on metaphorically, of course, you know, we've got to imagine this. But we can journey through those tough seasons, and the crown reminds us again and again and again that the victory is indeed ours. Now, if you want to get a physical crown, feel free to do that. I probably should have got one of my girls' play tiaras and put it on my head. And we could, it's not a crown, of course, but, you know, similar kind of thing. But the promise that Jesus made to the church in Smyrna in Revelation 2 is the same promise that he is making to you and me today. And that is that we will receive that crown of life, or that victor's crown. So church, as we finish this morning, I want to encourage you to remain steadfast in all seasons. Know that trials will come. I'm not going to back away from that. Know that there will be times when life will get uncomfortable. Know that your beliefs and your integrity will likely be questioned or attacked. I know that's not great news. It's not something, you know, that's going to actually make you jump up and down or put a spring in your step or bring a smile to your face. But the thing is, there's a lot of good news when it comes to the Bible, but there's also some stuff that's really hard to speak about and some stuff that is really hard for you to read. And I don't think that we can just cherry pick the things in the Word of God that give us those, you know, those butterflies and those good feelings and ignore the things that are challenging or difficult for us to read. We have to take the Bible in its entirety. And James makes it very clear that those trials will come. But the reminder for you is this: there's always a reason for what you are going through. Even if something is self-inflicted, God is going to use it to reveal your level of faith and maybe just lovingly turn you back to his word and to him and his presence so that any lack when it comes to your level of faith can be rectified. Because no matter what happens, God is for you. No matter what you're going through, he is on your side. And in all seasons, top of the mountain, deep dark valley, God loves you. Remember that word steadfast. Remember it means immovable, that something is fixed and nothing can change it. Well, in that context, look at what it says in Lamentations 3 verse 22. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. The steadfast love, the immovable love, it doesn't change. That love for you never ceases despite what you are going through. If you're going through some tough stuff right now, and I know that some people are, know that God still loves you. He hasn't forgotten about you. He knows what you're going through, and he is doing that journey with you. So church, I want to actually finish today with a time of ministry. And I think it's so very important for us to allow the Holy Spirit to come in and speak to us and minister to us from what I've been sharing today. Now, I know that there can be, you know, this kind of thought, the pastor's finished speaking, church is over. But this is very much part of our gathering online today. It's an important part of ministry when it comes to us as a church gathering together. So we're going to get into this time of worship. I ask you to push in to the presence of God. Speak those words, remain steadfast, and ask him for revelation that is relevant for your situation and for your particular circumstances. We're all going through different things at different times, but the King of Heaven knows exactly what that is, and more than that, knows exactly what it is that we need in terms of some encouragement in our spirit. And I believe that he's going to speak as we go into this time of worship. Thank you for your company today. Looking forward to seeing you next Sunday as we gather in person. Be blessed, church.
There may be storms that will move out. come to only test my faith. What I've learned about your favor, your mercy and your grace, is they go on forever. They're sufficient for today. When I'm worried about tomorrow, I won't be overwhelmed. And the burdens that I've carried, I will choose to lay them down. 'Cause what I've learned about your favor, your mercy and your grace, is they go on forever. They're sufficient for today. And all